speaker of this morning's session is Dr. Howard C. Van Wert. Dr. Van Wert has been a researcher at the Center for Applied Energy Research, University of Kentucky, for the past 3 years. He's been working mostly on salt gel synthesis of silica alumina coal liquefaction catalysts, but today he's going to talk to us about thiolidate precursors as used in coal liquefaction.
Thank you. I'd like to share on John, Edward Gibbons, myself, and John Layton from the Department of Chemistry, University of Kentucky, carried out these studies of thiolidate precursors, which were ammonium salts, and also that entails molybdenum sulfide cluster compounds. And the goal of our research was the conversion of coal to gasoline and other valuable products. Our objective is to evaluate these thiolidate and molybdenum sulfide cluster compounds as catalysts and optimize their performance in coal liquefaction. You might recall yesterday that Dr. Moore more or less laid out what companies are looking for vendors that more or less step up and say, we'd like to have this catalyst more or less used. Well, that is what we're doing, more or less, at least in the preliminary reactor stage before the pilot plant. And the precursors that we're proposing to sell to Ashland and any other company in carbide, but this, in this case, for coal liquefaction, are molybdates. In fact, we use ammonium heptamolybdate, which has a zero sulfur to molybdenum ratio as our reference catalyst. This is what it has been used in pilot plant work. And we will see our evaluation of that in a micro reactor. We also, in our study, we studied dioxythiomolybdate, which is ADTM, which has a 2-to-1 sulfur to molybdenum ratio, and also the tetrathiomolybdate, which is 4-to-1, 4 sulfurs to 1 molybdenum, and all three have the following structure. In addition to the molybdates, thiomolybdates, we investigated the following molybdenum sulfur clusters. The first is MO3. The ammonium is salt, is abbreviated MO3S13, which has a sulfur to molybdenum ratio of 4.3 to 1, and MO2S12, which has a molybdenum to sulfur ratio, sulfur to molybdenum ratio of 6-to-1. You will notice the complex structures of these clusters, whereas the molybdates are all, the molybdenum is part plus 6. In the MO3S13, the molybdenum is plus 4, and in MO2S12, the molybdenum is plus 5, which we will discuss possibly the effect of activity. Now, these four precursors were synthesized in our laboratory. In fact, the dioxythiomolybdate was synthesized from our reference catalyst, which was heptamolybdenum molybdate, which was done by bubbling H2 gas over a solution containing the ammonium heptamolybdate in ammonium hydroxide solution at 0 degrees, which gave us small orange crystals. In a similar fashion, we synthesized the ammonium thiomolybdate in the same way from our reference catalyst. If Dr. Moore is here, we're speaking to you figuratively, that but instead of doing it at 0 degrees and passing it over the solution, we bubble the H2S through the solution at 60 degrees and we got red. We don't like crystals. Now for the MO3S13, we do not use our reference catalyst, but we use ammonium molybdate. We added a polysulfide solution that we made up separately plus sulfur, and we reacted this into an autoclave, heated to 200 degrees to give us small purple needle-like crystals. Finally, our last precursor, the MO2S12, was synthesized using our dioxythiomolybdate, which was dissolved in methanol. Polysulfide solution was added to it and refluxed for 2 hours, which gave us a black solid. And these are the precursors that we then dissolved in water and dispersed onto coal, which I will describe momentarily. Now, our precursors were characterized by elemental analysis, powder diffraction, UV visible, IR, Raman, and NMR techniques. So now we come to coal liquefaction with our coal liquefaction technique. We dissolve for our coal liquefaction first each precursor in a 1% aqueous solution. Now, and we then pipetted a specified amount, which increased the water content of the coal sample about 5%. Now, the aqueous precursor solutions make the whole operation suspect because you have to assume that the precursor, when you add it to water, does not decompose, hydrolyze. Now, in the case of dioxythiomolybdate, MRO2S2-2 in this slide, it decomposes, it hydrolyzes in water. And here we have to show a molybdenum 95 following of the breakdown of MRO2S2. And you can see that after initial dissolving of the solution at 100%, it decomposes in 22 hours. 75% of it decomposes, and after 121 days, 77% of our dioxythiomolybdate has gone to molybdate, which is our reference catalyst, by the way, which is something to remember. And so that we more or less hold as suspect end results with dioxythiomolybdate because it is has been shown to be very liable to hydrolysis. So although we used 200 ppm of each precursor on coal, because of this hydrolysis, it's suspect whether we do really have 200 parts per million of that precursor. It has gone to molybdate and the other breakdown products, which include thiomolybdate, if you noticed. Overhead. Okay, now for coal liquefaction, you need coal. And the coal that we used was Wyodak, Black Thunder coal, and the moisture content of the coal was 8.9%. The sulfur is 0.35%, which we showed to be very necessary, and it was a cyanide bituminous coal of 17% oxygen. There are other things, but the slide would probably put everyone to sleep, I would think. But we have it if you need to discuss it. Now, this is a simulation of a pilot plant run. Pilot plant runs that we have done in New Jersey at HTI. And the solvent that we also put in the reactor was from Wolfenville, Alabama, pilot plant study in 1992. And it consisted of 67% resid, 33% distillate, 0% TH insolubles, 0.1% ash, and the following composition. Now for the co-liquefaction, which is which we've gone over roughly in the last few talks, I'm sure. In this case, we use 50 mL microautoclaves. I added 2.7 grams of the impregnated well-dyed coal, 4.1 grams of the distillate resid solvent. Then I pressurized it to 1,000 PSIG ambient pressure using ambient temperature using hydrogen or 2% hydrogen sulfide hydrogen. You will notice that hydrogen sulfide is in the second case, and that's very important. The reactor, which is sealed, is then put in a fluidized sand bath, run at 440 degrees, and shaken at 350 RPM for 30 minutes. That's very important. It's only 30 minutes because the time of residence in the reactor more or less might tell you whether or not how to evaluate the resid conversion, as we will discuss later. Now, after the reaction, it was quenched, the gas was measured, the volume of gas volume was measured, and then the product was scraped, a TH scrape was performed, and it was more or less put into a beaker. The beaker content of the product was then filtered through a thimble. The thimble was then, along with the filtrate, was put into a structural extraction apparatus, and it was run for 18 hours, more or less, making sure that anything soluble was solubilized from the thimble. Now, the thimble tells you how much of the coal did not react to product, as I will reiterate. Then the filtrate that we gathered after our 18-hour succulent extraction, we did a vapor distillation at 1 millimeter torr, which gave us cut points for the resid and the distillate. The distillate is what came across in the vacuum distillation, and the resid was what was left behind. Now, what was left behind was not converted to distillate. And that's very important. For what I will present as the results of our study. One is the THF percent conversion. This is the dissolution of the coal to resid. Now, when you do a reaction, the resid can also go to distillate, which is lighter material. But, so when I present data, results of THF percent conversion, dissolution of the coal, that means the coal, which I added 2.7 grams, has gone to resid and distillate. Now when I present data on percent resid conversion, that is how much of the resid from the coal has gone to distillate. So first of all, I'm going to present data on final updates and the molybdenum sulfide clusters. But first, let's go back to our reference catalyst, which is ammonium heptamolybdenum, which has been run at HTI. And we see, with no catalyst, TH conversion and also resid conversion. That is without any catalyst, but when we have the ammonium heptamolybdate, what do we see? We see a decrease in THF conversion or dissolution and also resent conversion, which is it's acting as a negative catalyst. Now, that was when we only added hydrogen to the coal salt admixture. When we add H2S, we see that we get more than 30% increase in the THF conversion. And resid is not formed, we have, well, it is formed, it's still way ahead of the AHM without the H2S, and it's ahead of the NOC, the reaction without any catalyst. So, that tells us something about our reference catalyst, but that is not the meat of our talk. As you can see, remember from our title, which was on precursor molybdate dates, we are asking the questions, are the final molybdates and the molybdenum sulfides through catalysts, and whether H2S improves the activity. And hopefully you will come to the same answer I do. Now, I will not be showing ADPM right away, because the results are somewhat suspect, but looking at tetrathiol molybdate and comparing its reaction without H2S, we see that for THF conversion, we have an enhancement, a catalytic increase in the dissolution of coal. However, for the resid, we have no enhancement. But when we add H2S, we have enhancements in both resid and the TH and the percent THF conversions. Going on to the first cluster compound, MO3S13, we have the same. It's very similar behavior. Without a catalyst, the MO3S13, we definitely see a THF conversion enhancement. Resid is negative. And when we have H2S, we have a very positive THF enhancement, although also, as you can see, a resid enhancement. Finally, for the last precursor, we have the MO2S12, and comparing it to the reaction without a catalyst, we see again a positive THF conversion enhancement, although the resid falls woefully short. When we add H2S, what is the effect of H2S? Those two questions. We have a definite enhancement, unless it activates the catalyst, which is woeful here, at least for the resid conversion, it is much better. Now, of course, the TH conversion is tremendously improved. So, now let us look at the precursors as shown individually together along with ADTM, which is the dioxin. And we see that, first of all, we have the catalysis, the non-catalytic state with no catalyst, but we have AHM. When we have no H2S, there is, what do we have? For resid conversion, we have no improvement compared to the non-catalytic state, but when we have H2S, we have a marked enhancement. for the THF conversion. This is the dissolution of the coal. We do not have the H2S. We have a positive enhancement, even for ADTM, very minor. But for the ATTM, MO3, MO2, S12, we have marked enhancements for the percent TH conversion. So we can say, conclude those two questions, that we indeed have a THF percent conversion catalyst in these three precursors. And with H2S, we have a marked increase in activity. And this leads us to the conclusions. When H2S is present, this first catalyst produced from molybdates, thiomolybdates, and molybdenum sulfide cluster polycatalysts have the same activity for coal dissolution and resin conversion, which is very high. But without H2S, coal dissolution, that's a percent TH conversion, appears only to be marginally increased with molybdenum precursors, as described. In conclusion, thank you very much, and I'd like to thank the Department of Energy for funding of this work. Thank you.
Questions?
Howard?
Yes?
Does it have to be H2S or there other sulfur compounds that we have?
Well, I believe that sulfur has been applied and hasn't been. Because WildTAC has 0.35% coal, which should be enough to activate AHM, the standard molybdate catalyst, without any sulfur to begin with. And you can see that unless you add H2S, it isn't activated. So without having done any rigorous research in this, I would say no. Yes?
I have a question and maybe a comment. I want to make sure I understand how you're defining your properties. You have the first one was the THF, which was the conversion of coal to resin. For 100 parts of coal, how much resin plus distillate do you get?
Right.
And the second one you had was the conversion of resin to distillate.
Right.
Now, do I understand correctly that says for 100 parts of resin, how much distillate do I have? Is that correct?
You mean the percent resin? When I put that up, percent resin?
Yeah, you had percent resin,
right.
And then you had percent distillate. Did you know? You had two things you were showing.
TH conversion and resin conversion.
Yeah, I'm sorry. For the resin conversion, that says for 100 parts of resin, how much distillate do you have?
From the coal goes completely to resin and distillate. For the coal that was converted to resid, how much of that went to distillate? That's what resid.
So what you're saying is for 100 parts of coal, how much goes to distillate?
Well, if you subtract out what was in the thimble.
My question is on the definition of
the
distillate. It can only be one of two things.
It has to be that
one. Which one is it?
It has to be
the base.
Okay, so it's
yes.
100
that's
parts
that's
of
MA3 coal.
How much goes the distillate?
Right.
So we put MA coal in the resin, so we count everything as a resin. That's the resin conversion.
I understand that. My question is, when you're looking at the amount of distillate, is it for 100 parts of MAF coal or for 100 parts of resin plus distillate?
For 100 parts of MAF coal.
Okay, thank you.
The denominator, as we saw in fact in Obama's the presentation on PMA, this equation was shown in a slightly different form. So coal MAF is in the denominator. That includes ILO and so forth.
Any more questions?
Yes?
Just to, so you're increasing the sulfur content of your product relative to the coal that you begin with?
The product.
Yeah, your resid and your distillate, does it have more sulfur per 100 parts than does a coal initially? Are you actually putting sulfur in your?
We're adding it to the reactor.
Right. Where's it going?
So where's the sulfur going, I think? Where does it end up?
So you are putting it into your product?
Your base product. And we didn't analyze the sulfur in the ore.
Okay. It's staying in the solid. You know, it interacts with the model to give you a model sulfur.
Yeah. That's why. But our model is very low.
Right, you have some sulfur going somewhere.
They're going to pH us in the form of S2S. We also add S2S in the reactor and more of them stay in the phase.
You see it stays in the gas phase. You don't see it in the resid or the distillate.
We didn't analyze the sulfur in the resid.
Well, that's a good question. It might be in there.
Questions?
Did you ever run an experiment without a catalyst using hydrogen sulfide?
No, it is not as shown. But there's been a lot of debate in the literature whether H2S really does do anything. There are reports that it increases, others said it decreases. It doesn't enhance like this in any way. As I showed, the coal had 3.35% sulfur in it to begin with. And you saw that AHM is a negative catalyst of using. And even when we added H2S to the catalyst, that's something that needs to be considered. And it's debated in the literature.
Any more questions? Let's thank Howard then.
Thank you very much. I would like to again thank all of the session chairs and the substitute session chairs invented on the last minute notice, our keynote speakers, all of the other speakers and participants who've come here. And we have two announcements, two pieces of business. And then when we are through, the lunch is at 12 o'clock in Salon D, which is next door. It's absolutely marvelous lunch for those of you who've been patient enough to stay in the inn. This is the Mountaineer Buffet dinner, which is very good. And what we have, I do want to mention our sponsors once more. If you're patient, Union Carbide Corporation, United Catalysts, Marathon Ashland Petroleum, Millennium Chemicals, Micromeretics, Fisher Scientific Chemical Abstracts, and Quantichrome ACS Colloid Surface Chemistry Division. And the piece of business that we have remaining is thank you. Diane Milburn is going to announce the winners of the election of the Tri-State Catalyst Club. Drum roll. Okay. Drum roll.
Before I announce the winners, I'd like to thank Barbara, who will be leaving as president, who served 2 years as president, and she's going to be a tough act to follow. She and Pat both have been very successful in obtaining a lot of financial support for the club, which has allowed us to supplement some of the students' travel and poster sessions and things. So I'd like to thank her. And if you get bored, we'll have other things that you can do, I'm sure. So moving into the position of president for 2 years will be Pat Doolin, who has been president-elect for 2 years. And we had quite a good slate of candidates this year for the elections. So thanks to all of them. And again, if you weren't elected this time, don't give up. More opportunities. The candidates for president-elect were X.D. Hu from UCI and Peter Smyrniadis from University of Cincinnati. And our next president-elect will be X.D. For secretary-treasurer, we had Dave Zalewski from Ashland Marathon and Anka Gentium from Union Carbide. And Dave Zalewski will be the next secretary-treasurer. And finally, for the position of director, we have four of those. We had, for one position, the candidates were John Hosmer from UCI and Dave Minahan from Union Carbide, and John Hosmer will be the president.